Windows 11, the operating system many of us thought we would never see, is coming soon, and Microsoft just revealed, well, definitely not all of the details, but many of the key details, including many things that could not be gleaned from the leaked build. In case you missed it, a leaked early unfinished build of Windows 11 surfaced not long after Microsoft announced their event to showcase what's next for Windows, featuring some minor UI changes, but overall nothing significantly different from how Windows 10 is today. This, however, was a very early and incomplete internal build, not a tech preview or a beta or anything like that. I'm EposVox, the stream professor, and what should you, the end user, know about Windows 11? Let's take a look. The presentation itself was weirdly overly emotional, full of dramatic pauses and tons of emphasis on things that weren't technology. So much specifically chosen rhetoric was used to put the spotlight on how you should always know our way around Windows, how Windows should feel familiar and secure, and so on, which is kind of amusing given that they are changing the UI again on us. Windows 11, visually, appears to be the ultimate unified Windows dream that Microsoft wanted for Windows 10. This combines ideas that they've had for Windows 8 and the original Surface tablets, the never-released Windows 10X tablet interface, the multiple attempts at a tablet mode for Windows 10 itself, and Windows Vista, oddly enough. So much aeroglass just everywhere. The goal is to have the user interface be super useful and adaptive for keyboard and mouse use, touch, and handwriting all together without necessarily hindering one of those specific workflows. They're really proud of their return to the aeroglass look, the rounded corners, transparent blurs, and smooth animations and transitions. In terms of using this new beautiful masterpiece of an OS, as they would have you believe, some UI tweaks have been made to help make you more efficient as a user. There's a huge focus on productivity and picking up where you left off, at least for hybrid setups involving laptops docked at secondary monitors or convertible tablet laptop computers, and even file sharing between your phone and your computer, which is kind of neat. The new start menu is centered by default, though you can left align it if you'd like, which is great, and it's supposed to be to more quickly deliver what they think that you want to access first. It's a cloud-powered start menu, which if the absolutely unusable search capabilities of the Windows 10 start menu compared to every previous version of Windows or even every other operating system on the planet is anything to go by, could be bad. Window snapping gets an upgrade here as well. A UI element has been added to the window decorations in the top right-hand corner of Windows to allow you to more easily arrange and align windows together in different, you know, layouts and things like that, however you'd like, much how certain power toys that have released or Display Fusion would let you, and create specific groups of windows. They didn't actually show this, but it would be immensely valuable for ultra-wide users specifically. You're also able to focus on a particular app, maximizing it or whatnot, and then return to the original Windows arrangement that you set up, or Snap Group, as they're calling it, through extra taskbar hover options as well, which is insanely powerful. This will be super useful for me for sure, as I always have a bajillion windows and having to realign them by hand, I usually just maximize everything after a certain point in my day. Plus, your window arrangements when using a secondary display with a laptop, for instance, will be remembered when you disconnect that display to take your laptop with you. And then all of the windows will go back to where you have them when you plug it back in, assuming you kept those programs open. Who knows how reliable this will be, but it sounds pretty handy for that specific user that they are targeting with this. This combines with an update to the virtual desktop functionality, allowing you to create as many as you need and allowing you to set custom wallpapers for each virtual desktop, so you can truly separate and identify different workspaces. I think most people prefer to keep their RAM available rather than having literally everything open at all times, whether you're gaming or doing schoolwork or whatever, as they talked about, especially on slower machines. But power users who keep a bajillion windows and Chrome tabs open like myself might actually get some use out of this, even if you have multiple monitors. Microsoft Edge gets the ability to display your list of tabs in a vertical list as well. There's also a new widget feed, similar to what they've been experimenting with in insider builds of Windows 10. This allows you to swipe from the edge to bring up a pane with an AI and manual input curated feed of helpful information, such as weather, news, stocks, and etc., and probably ads. They're probably gathering a ton of data here, to fill it with ads later. Hopefully there is a fair bit of customizability for this feature though, as the experimental Windows 10 feature just kind of resets everything after you change it after a while. You know what else involves ads? This ad for my merch. We've got an awesome desk mat, enamel pin, and stickers in a sleek 80s and 90s blank VHS cover design that I am super proud of. The desk mat is high quality, the stickers are perfect on just about anything, and the pin is great to show off at conventions. In 2022, probably. Head on over to eposvox.gg/merch or the link below to pick yours up today and get a free trial to Nebula. Also, we have free royalty-free rock and heavy metal music available to use in your streams and videos at backingtrack.gg or free downloads available in our Discord. Yes, I really just hit you with a double ad to prove my point about the Windows ads. These UI changes also aim to be more adaptive to different control methods. Switching a convertible laptop to tablet mode, for instance, spaces out the taskbar icons and makes the overall touch targets grow and be more lenient and touch-friendly. There's also work being done on handwriting recognition, voice typing, voice commands, and things like that. I just realized I produced this entire video without asking the important question that I still have, and that is, where the hell are our tabs? Where's the tabbed Explorer that they were experimenting with in the Insider build? Where's the tabbed Notepad and Office apps they were promising? Where's our tabs? I need more tabs! Okay, what about the tech? What about performance? Well, Microsoft finally remembered that Windows Hello exists and says it should be faster. Hopefully more webcams ship with Hello support in the future, because we have so very few dedicated webcams with it. We're also told that not only is browsing with Microsoft Edge faster, but browsing in any web browser is faster. Which should hopefully be neat if true. The speakers seem to completely stumble over Windows updates, or either some sort of attempt at a fourth wall knock to the audience.
Windows updates. Let's just Windows updates.
They did say that Windows updates should be 40% smaller and more efficient as they download in the background. But that is something that they've kind of always done, so okay. Supposedly CPU resource usage is more efficient, allowing laptop users to use less battery. That remains to be seen. It is also claimed that Windows 11 is the most secure Windows yet, which is one of those claims that you hope to hell is true, because why would you release a new operating system that is less secure than your last one?
I want to talk to you about something awesome.
Gaming.
If you're a gamer, Windows 11, it was made for you.
You're gaming.
But most of the things they discussed already exist. Like Game Pass. But it does appear auto HDR is becoming the norm for Windows 11 and might even be Windows 11 exclusive, with over 1,000 games getting auto enhanced, which is impressive. This happens via DirectX and shouldn't require additional patches directly from developers. It's worth noting the demos that they showed, even though it's hilarious to use a 10-year-old game as your example, aren't going to look right in a SDR stream, so the comparison point is kind of moot. Direct storage was teased again, which won't make an appearance immediately, but could be huge down the road. This allows your graphics card to more efficiently and quickly load data from really fast NVMe SSDs to allow for game-changing results like the dimension shifting in Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart on PlayStation 5. Microsoft also announced, after this specific part of the event, the GDK, an open game development kit that allows easy cross-platform development across Windows and Xbox. Plus, they've integrated AMD's FSR, or FidelityFX Super Resolution, upscaling tech right into it. This runs on any GPU, even non-AMD ones, and doesn't perform quite as well as DLSS just yet, given that DLSS is getting lots of updates and things like that, but it allows games to get a performance boost without sacrificing quite as much quality due to this upscaling method. And now there's virtually no excuse for games to not ship with it. Plus, by being in this cross-platform GDK, this may appear on Xbox as well now, though the usual TAA or dynamic resolution scaling methods used for consoles will generally do better here. For video chatting, Microsoft Teams is getting deeply integrated into Windows, allowing for anyone to freely and easily connect with friends and family on any device, which is pretty neat, and I love that they are integrating it. For the people who keep asking, but what about Skype? It's weird that they're doing this when they acquired Skype. Microsoft acquired Skype basically to integrate its tech into Teams. At this point, Teams relies on a ton of Skype tech and will probably replace Skype long term. Microsoft just has to get over the branding hurdle of Teams being viewed as a workplace tool, also competing with Skype for Business, but that's their own problem. The Windows Store is getting a facelift, as we were already told about, allowing users to easily find streaming media across any streaming service which is neat. The whole store experience is supposed to be way easier to use and more intuitive. On the back end, major things are coming. They're making it so software and content developers can list their programs in the Windows Store, whether it's a PWA app, a UWP app, or normal Windows or Win32 code. Even better, a big focus on allowing developers to monetize in here in a way that, from what I can tell, is a huge deal, especially in the context of the Epic v. Apple lawsuit. Microsoft wants to make it easy for developers to earn money through their Windows Store with revenue sharing, with the drop to taking a lower cut that we knew about already, which I believe is 12% instead of 30%, or if the developer brings their own revenue engine, they can keep 100% of their revenue, no extra cut taken off the top. This is big. They've also partnered with Adobe to demonstrate this and bring the Creative Cloud Suite to Windows Store, finally. Even better for users, Android apps are coming, at long last. Using Intel Bridge technology, which will work on any x86 CPU, AMD, or Intel, or otherwise, Android apps can behave similarly to Windows apps directly on the desktop, even getting support for the new window snapping. This is pretty neat. It's still going to be emulated in some degree, but it should make tools like BlueStacks or Nox, neither of which are an enjoyable experience to actually use anyway, mostly unnecessary. We'll see how gaming performance holds up for those who want to play games on it, though, as time allows. The only caveat here being a really strange and kind of off-putting partnership with Amazon. The Amazon App Store, which I didn't even know still existed post-Fire Phone, is being added to the Windows Store. So you first have to have and sign into your Microsoft account to access the Windows Store, and then download the Amazon App Store, and then have and sign in with an Amazon account to then download the Android apps. While the workflow and even searching for apps will actually be completely seamless once you're set up, privacy concerns are going to be everywhere here with this. Plus, there may be apps that just aren't available in the Amazon App Store in the first place. Hopefully, smart people will figure out ways to sideload APKs fairly quickly. The event ended with some strange quotes like, "There is no personal computing without personal agency," and "Personal computing requires choice," and wanting users to be empowered to choose the applications we run, the content we consume, and the way that we allocate our attention, which are some really, really poignant and bold, but also bizarre claims in the face of what is a huge push for AI-curated feeds directly in the operating system and what could otherwise be seen as much removal of personal agency. So, yikes there. Like I said, the emotions were wild in this presentation. For final details, Windows 11 will be available as a free upgrade from Windows 10 this holiday and start shipping on PCs this holiday as well. This means that in all likelihood, your Windows 7 and Windows 8 keys will also continue to work for activating Windows 11. Experimental insider builds will start being available supposedly next week, which will be pretty cool, and there's a tool available now to check and see if your computer will be compatible with Windows 11. But there is a weird thing that will tell most of you that your computer is not compatible. Windows 11 requires TPM, which is a relatively new security module. Most, if not all, PCs and motherboards ship with this disabled by default. Older PCs may not even have this at all. Some of them may or may not have a place for you to connect a physical TPM module for it that you would have to buy separately. Either way, you'll probably be told that your PC isn't ready for Windows 11 without enabling this. In BIOS, it's usually called FTPM or PTT over on Intel. It's often in the secure boot section of your BIOS. Enabling this should get you the all clear to upgrade, if your motherboard supports it in the first place. I expect a lot of issues to crop up over this decision, however. It may also be possible that they don't require this for upgrades, since it currently isn't enabled for just about anyone in the world, but will require it for new machines shipping with Windows 11. We'll see. Also, this requirement could completely rule out any Apple computer, Intel or otherwise, from running Windows 11, which is something. Also, as a final compatibility note, Windows 11 will only run on 64-bit CPUs. They're not phasing out 32-bit apps yet like macOS did, but older 32-bit only CPUs will not be able to run Windows 11. Honestly, those likely barely work anymore given that modern OSs require more than 4 gigs of RAM and not work well for modern tasks or applications anyway. Just keep in mind in case your grandma gets a wild idea to run Windows 11 or something. That's unlikely, but you never know. Overall, I'm quite happy with what's going on here with Windows 11. I understand that the desire for there to have been more to show is present, but realistically, this was the 21H2 update for Windows 10 that they had already been planning, and they packaged it up as a new version of Windows to completely start anew because they wanted to make so many major changes to the UI and things like that, along with a bit of a new outlook or philosophy shift. We'll see in time if this plays out like every other alternate release of Windows does. Hopefully it's not another Windows Vista or Windows 8. I honestly think that it would have made way more sense to launch at least the beta builds alongside this event rather than having it so detached from actually being able to use the operating system, but alas, that's how they're doing it. What are your thoughts on Windows 11? Join us on Discord to discuss. Hit the like button if you enjoyed, subscribe for more tech education just like this, and go get some of that sweet, sweet merch before it's gone. Be kind, rewind.